Guys, at the time of recording this, I'm turning 30 in 2 days. Whoo, that's crazy. The only reason I'm excited about turning 30, honestly, is so I can blast Bo Burnham's I'm Turning 30 all day long. Shamelessly, just dawn till dusk, you know?
I used to run for miles. I used to ride my bike. I used to wake up with a smile and go to bed at night with a dream. Now I'm turning 30. No.
My 20s have been such a wild ride. I feel like I've lived a million lifetimes in my 20s. Like, this has been like one of the most significant, I guess, periods of time in my life. I think that your 20s should be that. Like, it's the time to like explore, figure everything out. Not everything, because good luck with that, but it's the time to explore and, you know, not get too rigid in anything, because your Saturn return hasn't even happened yet. If you're into astrology at all, that happens in your late 20s, early 30s, and there's just a lot that can change, you know. I think I was gonna say that's why I think a lot of like young marriages fail, but I don't think there's any data to support that. Like, marriages are just a crapshoot either way. Like, forget I said anything about that.
Georgia.
But I just feel like your 20s is a really like evolutionary time for you as a human. And so today I wanted to share a few things that I learned from my 20s, as well as a little bit about what I'm looking forward to in my 30s and how I feel going into this new decade. I want to talk just briefly about some of the big life changes I went through in my 20s. Not only did I graduate college and move from Boston to Austin, I also ended a 7-year relationship when I was 28. So most of my 20s were in that relationship, 20-ish to 27, 28. And I had multiple jobs throughout this time, freelance, businesses I was launching, jobs, startups, all kinds of different things I tried to do for work. I continued to work on, I started a documentary project that still isn't done yet, like almost 10 years later. I guess I might have started that at 19, but yeah, so I mean, I started projects that, you know, are lifelong projects, and I got sober multiple times. I think my first sobriety stint was in 2019 or 18. I think 2018. 2018 and 19. So I would have been, drumroll, how old was I? So when I was 24, so like in my early mid 20s, I was already trying to get sober, and then I, you know, obviously spent still half that time not sober. So I had sobriety stints, 2 of them in my 20s, and now I'm going into my 3rd. I had my car broken into and lost a ton of money. I got screwed over by coaches in the business and entrepreneurship industry. I bought into some really woo-woo bullshit and lost a ton of money. So I've learned all about credit card debt. And I also experienced an amazing retreat where I met like mentors 3 times my age. Okay, at least 2 times my age. And they taught me like how to be deeply seen and held by other people. And they taught me so many valuable lessons. And I met some of the most incredible people in this decade. It's really been a time too of like getting back to the core of who Savannah is, or who Sav is. I use both names interchangeably. Apparently still don't know who I am. But like, I feel like, you know, in high school and college and school, we start to bury ourselves a little bit, and work too. But honestly, at least the last part of my 20s has been peeling back the layers and getting back to the truth about me and who I am and remembering who I was as a kid. And all of that has led to some pretty profound breakthroughs and healing that has happened just in the last few years. So I'm excited to put all this time into perspective for you guys and talk a little bit about what I know now to be true. All right, so the first thing that I want to share is that you already have all the answers you need. In my 20s, I was so focused on getting permission from other people. I wanted other people to tell me what to do, show me the way, fix it for me, help me figure this out. And as it turns out, my inner guidance or compass or intuition was guiding me all along, and it was often always right. You know, I can't really be mad about any of the things that I tried, you know, the business coaches or the relationship, because they taught me so much. But deep down, I already knew the answers that I needed, and I was just looking for external validation. You are the person who knows you best, and only you can truly guide you through anything in your life. Like, you're the only person that knows every single moment you've lived through. Nobody else has that. So don't give that power away to somebody else as well. This next one is kind of similar, but live your own story and nobody else's. It's so easy to get focused on other people and what other people are doing and wanting to be like someone else. But there's so much power in telling the truth with yourself and learning how to live in your own story. This story is yours and it's epic, especially if you start to really lean into it and find your unique blend of all the things you love about all these other people. Once you can kind of narrow it down and be your own niche, be your own thing, you'll really start living in your own story. And I can tell you, it just unlocks miracle after miracle, and life just gets better and better the more you can really embrace what's yours and what's always been here. A big part of that is about learning to tell the truth with yourself and with others. I feel like I learned this the most from going through AA, which I did a couple of times. And, you know, in that program, you're required to unpack and uncover the truth about how you behave and the things you've done to others and the resentments you have for them and why you have those, and then go back and make amends and really like tell the neutral kind of honest truth about what you did or how you behaved. And I learned the same thing in coaching. You know, I was trying to learn how to forgive someone in my life, and I learned that I had to stop telling a certain story about me being a victim and about my life, and learn to just get down to the facts and tell myself the truth. And that can mean a couple different things. Like, there's like the truth about who you are, which is like this big metaphysical thing. Like, you're a spiritual being having a human experience, and you're so much bigger than, you know, your little human body and all your little human thoughts. But then there's also just the truth about, like, what are the facts of this situation, and like, where am I spinning out and creating something unnecessarily versus what actually happened and the impact of what happened. So learning how to parse those things out will help you get to that bigger truth. Like, first you got to get to the little truths throughout the day. Like, just stop lying to yourself. Stop with the little lies to yourself, to other people. If you catch one, just be like, oh, that was weird. I don't know why I said that. Actually, this is what happened. Or actually, this is how I feel. Or actually, this is what I want. And like, learning how to do that is incredibly powerful and will free you up so much. And there's nothing more powerful than like owning your truth, honestly. Honestly, like, it makes you feel so aligned and so proud of yourself and good about your impact in the world. So highly recommend learning to tell the truth. Okay, so next is about getting seen. And what I mean by that is finding people in your life who see you the way you see you. Because it creates this, I guess, external validation and just like deep understanding. You know, growing up as a kid, I was very sensitive and I felt like a lot of people didn't get me. And so it can be isolating and you feel alone, right? And so later in my life, I've started to keep track of who are the people in my life. I call them my committee members. And they're alive. Some of them are alive, some of them are dead, some of them are friends, some of them might even be, you know, a singer, a songwriter, right? Like, oh, that artist really gets me. Like, I feel connected to them. But write down who your committee members are. Like, who are the people that understand you? And it's even better if you can find those people in real life or in person. They might be in a community that you need to sign up for. They might be on a retreat, or friends that you meet, mentors you meet, people you meet. But there's really nothing more powerful than being like deeply understood for like the depths of who you are. I also sometimes call it like, these people are from my planet, like, and so I'm over there on my little planet with like Brian Perry and my teacher who passed away, and you know, Taylor Swift. So like, you can just kind of like, I don't know, call on these people or remember them or reflect on them when you're feeling like nobody understands you. And it's not a diss to anyone who's not on your planet, so to speak. We all just like are different, and it's good to have people in your corner that you know deeply understand you. So get to your planet, you know, find your planet, find your people, and get seen. All right, I want to talk about mentorship a little bit, because I struggled a lot with mentors in my 20s. I wanted to pay people to be my mentor, like coaches and you know, people who told me that they could help me make my business thrive and or help me figure out the, you know, depth of who I am or whatever. And sadly, not all mentors are good for you or good for anyone. And so the qualifier for me in a mentor is, do they point me back to myself? Do they remind me to look inwards instead of being like, here's how you must do it. This is my way and my way is right. And if you do these 10 things, like, you'll have X, Y, Z. No, like, we all operate differently. The same system is not going to work for everyone. It's one thing, it's great for people to share what they've learned, and I might even go back into coaching myself, but like, I feel like the difference is helping people reconnect with who they are, what works for them, and letting that guide them through their life, and then just encouraging that and reminding that is really what a coach or a mentor, you know, should be. And then some of the best mentors I found aren't the ones I paid for. There are people I met through experiences or on Instagram and connected with, or just kind of stumbled upon. And they're the really magic mentors because, you know, they're not selling you anything. They don't have anything financial to gain from giving you advice or being your friend or hearing you out, spending time with you. So definitely look out for those types of people as well. Okay, this next one's a big one, and it's about stepping into your purpose. At some point, you're gonna have to be willing to step into what's calling you. Something is probably calling you. It might be small, it might be big, but there's a thing in front of you that, until you do that thing and face that thing, you're not really gonna make a lot of progress in other areas of your life, in my experience. And so, do the thing that's in front of you. Truly start listening to your intuition, and I call them divine inklings, but they're these little things that pop up like, ooh, I want to do that, or that's interesting, or like, curious about that. That's your intuition, that's your inner guide. And, you know, I think about the Kacey Musgrave song, follow your arrow wherever it points. Shouldn't say follow your arrow when it points straight, like, or gay. Okay. She didn't say follow your arrow like it's gonna be a straight line, you know? She said wherever it goes, because I feel like your arrow's gonna like ping pong around in all these different directions, and that's gonna become like your North Star. Like, you're gonna ping pong kind of in a direction. And unfortunately, life's just not linear like that. So learn to follow your arrow in circles until you kinda, you know, circle your way into a direction. Shit works, I don't know. Kacey Musgraves was right. All right. Here's the next one. Consistency doesn't always mean the same thing every single day at the same time. And that's a little extreme, but a lot of times, you know, we can feel like, oh, if I don't work out every day, I'm not being consistent, or oh, I need to write every day, or whatever it is. And, you know, as a neurodivergent person, consistency was not my strong suit for a long time. And I started to lose self-trust and started to believe that I could not be consistent with anything, and that I would just continue to fall on my face when it came to consistency and trying to build any habits or build any routine or make gains at the gym. And what I found is that actually consistency is more about finding a way to show up for the minimum of that thing. So take whatever it is that you're trying to do, like let's say it's going to the gym, and boil that down to what is the core like value beneath that thing. So it's not really about making gains at the gym or being consistent at the gym or blah, blah, blah. It's just about, I need to move my body every day because I know that my brain feels better when I move my body every day. So then ask, what's the minimum and what's the maximum? So for me, my minimum for moving my body is either like 10 minutes on the treadmill or yoga at home, or yeah, walking around the block. Like, those are my minimums. Like, if I can't do the full thing today, I can do that. And then you have your maximum, which is a full hour and a half workout and running on the treadmill and, you know, feeling that high and getting all that, those endorphins going and all that stuff. And then I use this I got from Matt Devella, the 2-day rule. Like, I can miss one day, but I can't miss 2 days in a row. So that helps a lot because it just helps you, like, it's okay if I miss today, but I can't miss tomorrow, or I know I want to have that sort of backup day for when I know I'm going to need it, so I'll go today and do the minimum because I want to be able to use that. It's kind of like having a little pass card, you know, that you get to have and keep in your pocket for when you really need it. So then you just have to be honest about yourself when you need it. And anyways, those things have really helped me be consistent. I've proved to myself with YouTube that I can be consistent. Turns out I just wasn't doing things I liked or being gentle enough with myself and compassionate enough with myself, like, to reach consistency. So you have to allow yourself to have those ups and downs, those low days and high days and everything in between, because that's going to let you be consistent. You're still going to be making progress. Your progress doesn't have to be the same every day. So that was a really big thing for me when it comes to consistency. And the last thing I want to leave you with is that your time will come. Divine timing is out of your control, and that's a good thing. A lot of times we want things to happen on our timeline, but the truth is we have absolutely no control over it. And I truly believe that if you're here and you're watching this, you're searching and you're seeking and you're doing the work to try to understand yourself better, try to make changes, try to move in the direction of you want, following your arrow, you know, like we talked about, your time will come. It might not be time for you right now to leave that relationship. It might not be time for you to start that business or that YouTube channel. Like, you might not be ready, and that's totally okay. Like, I had to allow myself to say, like, I don't have to figure this out right now. I don't have to do anything right now. Like, give yourself permission also. Like, as important as it is to do all these things and do this work, you also have to give yourself, it's like this duality, right? Of like, you're pushing forward and you're gentle and giving yourself permission to not push forward. And that is where, like, so much growth happens, because you can trust your own process, trust your own timing, and you're not pushing yourself out of your comfort zone unnecessarily. Like, it's not healthy to just push yourself out of your comfort zone 24/7. Nobody can do that. Like, you have to rest, you have to repair, you have to have seasons in your life. Yeah, just trust that everything has its timing and know that you'll get there when you're ready to get there. And the life is setting you up for the perfect time and the perfect season. And trust that, because unfortunately you have also no other option. All right, guys, so that's all I have for you today. Those are the 7 biggest lessons I learned from my 20s. I'm really looking forward to going into my 30s from a really aligned place, from a really grounded place. Like, I feel like I know who I am. I know what I'm about. I know what I like and don't like. I know how to tell the truth with myself. I know how to listen to my intuition. I know how to be gentle with myself and compassionate with myself and trust in timing. And I don't have everything figured out. I certainly have so much more to learn, but I've got to say I am kicking off my 30s from such a better place than I did in my 20s. And if you're making it through your 20s right now, just know, like, one, nothing lasts forever. Like, you will be 30 at some point. I mean, unless you're not around. And I hope you make it to 30, because so far it already seems brighter and better and just, you know, a more grounded place. So do everything you can to learn about yourself during this time, you know? It's never too late to learn any of these lessons or to figure them out. So cheers to learning lessons in 2024, and I'll see you guys on the other side.